Hello, everyone. It was very excited day and even entire week. We have a lot of great people and interesting talks. And I hope my session will be useful for you too. I'm going to talk about threat modeling. Threat modeling is one of the most powerful tools in application security toolkit. But you know, 3 years ago, on Nova Space Rail, my regular co-speaker, Efrat Wasserman, and I were only person who touched on this topic. And today we have a lot of talks on this session about threat modeling and even multi-day classes. And it's really good because the topic is so huge that we always can find another angle to discuss. We just need to remember that some bigger picture exists. Just to illustrate my point, maybe you know the famous story about elephant in dark room. I cannot put dark room on slide, so I take another version about a few blind people asked to describe the elephant, and everyone described it differently. And in reality, every one of them was right. But the problem is that nobody saw the general picture. And threat modeling as a discipline is really very like to elephant, and we always need to understand what part of this elephant we are touching now. So I believe everyone in this room knows how elephant looks like, and we today talk about very specific part, let's say front right leg of elephant. In terms of threat modeling, it will be threat modeling in product security. So since we have a very short time, it's very high level session. We only scratch the surface. We will not deep dive too much. But we talk a little bit about the main concept and the methodologies using in threat modeling. I'll touch a little bit how we do threat modeling in our organization. Not too deep, just to give you some background for next step. And on the next step, we will make the model a little bit complicated by adding a new dimension. And also, I provide you a couple of examples and tips which came from my experience. And I have very long experience in both software development and application security. In my 25 plus years experience, I went through many various roles, starting from software developer to technical lead to system architect. And last 7 years, I am working in a big software company responsible for security of one of the biggest product group in our Microfocus company. So for beginning, let's agree about terminology. If you run some fast search on the internet, you will find dozens of definitions of threat. And in reality, a threat is anything, a process, a tool, a person, even an event which can harm your environment. And how it can harm you? By exploiting vulnerability. Vulnerability is some weakness in your product, on your environment. And also, the classical approach says that it is a data. But from my perspective, anything which has a value is an asset. It might be data, it might be CPU power, it might be disk space, it might be time of your employees, and even something which is not so tangible as company reputation, it's also an asset. And every asset should be protected. And risk, this is a combination of all of this. Risk, this is a possibility to the threat to exploit vulnerability, to damage or compromise your asset. So let's play a short game, true or false. Let's read this together. Threat modeling should be performed at the design stage, equally covering every part according to threat methodology based on DFD visual representation. Do you agree? Who thinks it's right? I think it's right. And who is thinking it's right, also right. But remember the elephant? We all partially right. Because we can do it in many, many different ways. As we in Israel now, we will analyze this sentence from right to left. So let's see this DFD representation, well-known, very well-established, widely used. But recently we understood that it's not really suitable to application security because it's not represent real architecture of our products. So there is another approach to use process flow diagram. It much better reflect your architecture of your product and more suitable for application security. We have another simple representation. We call this communication matrix. You know all moving parts of your application and understand how they move and how they communicate each other. Stride, also very, very well known, proposed by Microsoft many years ago, named according to initials of threat categories, spoofing, tampering, repudiation, etc. But we have a lot other abbreviations in threat modeling. Why we are not using them? We have PASTA, the seven-step process, which aligns business and technological requirements and provides the attacker view. We have VAST, promoted by a threat modeler and recognize the difference between applicational threat model and operational threat model. And also use the process flow diagram for visualization. And we have other methodologies. I will not talk about everyone, but we know two of them very similar. One called Attack Tree, and the second, security control enumeration. They're pretty similar. But one just enumerates all possible attacks on your asset, the second all also possible protection of your asset. So equal coverage, it's pretty obvious, no need to drill down, but most interesting is this incremental threat modeling idea. You can envelop all previously developed part of your application as a legacy blob, and concentrate only on most dangerous part of your application, new changes or new additions. I first heard this term from Irene Michelin on OWASP Europe, on her session about incremental threat modeling. Very useful, very interesting. And I really like it because it was very suitable to our idea to work according to security impact of components. Don't cover everything equal. Identify most risk areas and work according to this. And we all know that by the book, the best stage to run threat modeling is the design stage. But in reality, it's very suitable to waterfall applications. When you have very well-documented design, strictly followed by next stages. But in reality, we don't have now boundaries between design and implementation. So we're doing our best to run threat modeling somewhere on this combined stage. But we still have time to catch some major risk and mitigate them on pre-production. Production is usually pretty late for product security, but we have some organization who supplies their products as a service. So this is the best time to run threat modeling together with infrastructure team and create very deep and comprehensive threat model for entire deployment. And post-production, someone said, so it's too late. No, it's very useful if you have some incident response to analyze, or you just want to improve your product and you can find here a good solution. Also, we all live in a real world and we understand the world has restrictions. We have resource restrictions, we have time restriction. Sometimes we inherit the application from another team and they don't build threat model for us. And sometimes we just miss the best opportunity and we need to recap backward. So we can rephrase the first statement in very general way. We can say you can run threat model in any stage, covering any part, according to any methodology, according to any visualization. Most important, it must be consistent. It must be consistent And it should be aligned with your corporate policies and processes. So in our company, we say this in this way. We say we're doing this as early as possible. We work in according to security impact. We built our own methodology. We wasn't shy. We're a big company, we can do what we want. And we built own visual representation, as we call communication matrix. So how we reach this? Because we understood the component-based model simplifies our threat model significantly, because we can split our system by logical or physical or some combination of these components. And also it's very flexible because we can zoom into component or zoom out according to how component is ready for threat modeling, what we know about this component, etc. In addition, it helps us to involve development teams because we can find the component owner and make him or her part of our threat modeling exercise. So this is a little bit detailed view how we're running this, building this model. When we understand functionality of our product and we have basic network diagram and understood the deployment, we start the decomposition exercise. We create list of components. We attribute every component. We create list of communication channel between components and attribute every channel. From this, we build communication matrix and understand the impact of every component in our system. Also, we did something not so conventional. And if we have here people who speak Stride natively, don't throw your boots on the stage. We translated Stride to simple English because of this. Because when I come into my developers and say them spoofing or tampering, this is what I see. And when I say repudiation, I lost my counterpart completely. So what we did, we took the security controls approach and translated this to this security patterns. We using this a lot, and people, developers can understand this. And what we study during this exercise, we understand that even privacy and security does not have, don't have the same purpose. It's very convenient to address privacy concern during threat modeling. And it helps us to provide basic privacy by design principles when we develop our products. It saves us a lot of time and effort, and it is highly recommended to combine these efforts. Important point I want to remind you that we are talking about product security. It means we are not responsible on infrastructure or network. So our threat model only on things which we can control. And let's take this, some simple application, for example, very simple. Knows only one thing, to upload attributed file to server. So we have client, which is talking to server, and server puts attributes to database and files to files repository. This is two-way representation of the same system as DFD and as communication matrix. So we run the decomposition exercise. We have all components in this very complex system. We know everyone. We understand how they talk each other and what is most important for us to analyze. So this is our patterns, and as I say, we can validate only things we are controlling. And we are controlling business logic. Sorry. Business logic. And we are controlling executables, which is running this business logic. So we built our patterns with some questionnaires, with exactly the same questionnaire. And we ask the same about, for example, authentication in our application. For example, we understand that anonymous user might be a threat because anonymous user can abuse our system in many different ways. Also, we want to ensure that user have permissions to get to proper files, so we need to implement some proper file sharing. Also interesting thing when we're talking about authorization in the process level, you know, when you come to developer to start to talk about list privileges, principles, etc., they say, oh, okay, okay, we understood, but nothing happens. And when they run threat modeling and understand that their process has excessive privileges, and if it can, might be compromised, it might destroy their file repository, we really have something changes. I recently had someone approach me and say, Lena, I understood what you're talking about. I create a user story and we're going to fix it in this release. So this is really what we want to achieve when we involve development team in threat modeling. So we build our model. We understand every risk in our system. We're really happy. But we receive nice surprise. Development team decided to supply the application in container. Why? Because container makes the operational team life much easier. We have lightweight virtualization. It's cool. We have very consistent, simple, continuous environment management. And also our product team benefits from very easy packaging of our application and distribution of our application. But does the container make security better? Really, we don't know. We can answer the question directly and immediately. And also, I want to say the container, this is just a symptom of a new reality we are living in. Because reality is adopting itself constantly according to new technologies and new security requirements. And people who know me know I like real-life examples, and I have real-life examples for you. I recently got the message by WhatsApp, a pretty funny message, and I recreated it here. It's 1998, we have basic security requirements, don't enter to car with strangers. I believe we don't have people in the room who know, don't remember 1998. If you don't, ask your parents, they will confirm it was true. So 10 years later, we have new security rule. Don't meet people from internet alone in person. And what we have now, we have Uber. We connect with people, with stranger people on the internet, and immediately go to their car. How many people here use some ride-share service? Who never heard this two security rules before? So we understand the reality is changing. Same happened with containers. In same very far 98, we have rule. We will not talk third party from unknown sources. Later, we have the rule, we don't change our production without change management. What we have now, Docker pull something latest. Very nice. Back to your office, check your production, how many Docker runtimes you have, you will be surprised. So another challenge we receive with containers, network. Infrastructure team spends years to build good segments, to protect every segment in network, to put database in most protected segment. And what container did to us, besides the fact that now application security have to think about network again, they might remove your segmentation completely. If you are using Kubernetes with a basic network flannel overlay, you don't have segments anymore. Because this network overlay does not support segments. And even Kubernetes started to implement network policies two years ago. According to my knowledge, flannel don't implement anything related to network policies. Does it mean we need to run now to our office immediately to replace this network backend? I cannot say you. You need to run to threat modeling and understand your real risk. Maybe you don't have real risk in this new mode. So, as I said, we have another additional complexity level in our deployment model. We need to think about our business logic, our executables, and our containers. And we did this exactly. We started this project with my former colleague Vitaly, who is here. Thank you, Vitaly. And we ran a lot of research with our development team, and we understood this is not so different from each other. We can continue exactly with same patterns, with same questions, but we need now to think about how user inside application authenticated, how process inside container authenticated, how container inside the cluster authenticated. What permissions have user inside the application? What permission has product inside the container? What permissions has container inside the pod or host? And here you can see a couple of real examples. We recently got these lessons, and it was really useful for us to understand this is that security requirements has some background, and development team also understood that security requirements has some background. So when we study the authentication pattern, we identify threat of unknown container. As I said, we are not owners of infrastructure, so we really don't know who deploy what containers together with our application on the same host, on the same pod. And we recommended to our development team to use certificate-based authentication. And they did this. And I want to remind you that our risk, the possibility to threat, to exploit some vulnerability, to damage your asset. And vulnerability might come on any level. In our case, it came from Kubernetes itself. It was critical CVE. Fortunately for us, it has workaround. Workaround says you can put a flag, disable anonymous access, and it will reduce exploitability significantly. And because we know that all our containers authenticated, we can apply the flag without destroying our functionality. So our customers had time to apply patch and fix the problem, and it was very good. Another real-life example also, when we check authorization pattern, we understood that compromised container, inside the container some process run with excessive privileges, might escape and get root privileges. And we recommended to our development team to use Docker user namespace feature. And team started to follow this principle. And most recently, we have the known run-C escape vulnerability. And if you run in proper namespace, it will not affect you. So it's very important to understand these points and promote them in your development teams. So to conclude the session, I want to say you that our current deployment became similar to Onion. Or if you like Shrek, to Ogres. Or if you don't like boss, to cakes. Everyone likes cakes, yes? So vulnerability can be found on any layer of your deployment. And when you run threat modeling, you should analyze every layer of your deployment. And to conclude, I want to return to my starting point. Threat modeling is most powerful tool in application security toolkit. Unfortunately, it's often overlooked due to some misconceptions. And we can improve the situation by increasing flexibility, by simplifying the process and language. If you understand that your counterpart don't understand you, change the language. Don't be so straight fan to explain to people that repudiation is not repudiation. Explain them in another language. and involve development team in the threat modeling process. Not just consult with them, involve them. And I don't know how many software architects we have in the room. If you have some, return to your office, run the threat modeling, and you will study a lot about your application. You will know much more than you know now. And obviously, we need feedback. We need continuous improvement. And we should not be afraid to experiment. If something not suitable to our organization, try to adopt the methodology and use it according to your processes and policies. Just remember what part of elephant you're touching now. This is very important. And run threat modeling on any stage, by any methodology, with any people involved, just do it. Thank you.